Welcome, listeners, to Connect the Dots. I'm Alison Rose Levy. We're here with you every Wednesday at 10 a.m. Eastern Time on the Progressive Radio Network. Each week on Connect the Dots, we connect the dots between all of the different sectors of our society and how they interact to create our well-being, the well-being of our communities, our society, and the planet Earth. I'm a longstanding journalist in these areas, and we report on them talking to different thought leaders, activists, journalists, experts, scientists, and more. On this week's show, I'm really delighted, and you can hear the background noise because we're at Netroots Nation this week conference. And my guest today is Ryan Grimm, who's an author, former Washington bureau chief for HuffPost and The Intercept, and a liberal progressive political commentator. His writings have appeared in multiple publications, including Rolling Stone, The Washington Post, Politico, and of course, The Intercept. We're here today with Brian to discuss his new book, wonderful title, We've Got People. From Jesse Jackson to Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, The End of Big Money and the Rise of a Movement. Welcome to Connect the Dots.
Yeah, thanks for having me here. Yeah, I was originally going to call it They've Got Money, We've Got People. That was just too much of a mouthful. But that was, the line is kind of stolen from Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez's viral campaign ad, mm-hmm. where she says of her race with Joe Crowley, this is a battle between money and people. You know, they've got money, we've got people. And I thought that was a nice, succinct way of putting it.
Well, you know, it couldn't be more timely today as we're in the midst of, you know, the nomination and the running of candidates for the Democratic nomination. And every week there's a new poll where we're seeing, you know, how somebody's doing, how much money did they raise, how many people raised that money, what were the donations they gave. And so there's this constant tension between the needs of money and the needs of people. Which do we put first? Do we put first that somebody is, you know, raised X amount of dollars and this makes them the number one leading candidate? Or, you know, how do we actually parse those things?
So it's interesting. For the first time in this campaign, people are looking at money in different ways. Everybody has always thought of money as fungible. So, you know, $1 million is $1 million. But this cycle, candidates for the first time are not publicizing who their bundlers are. You know, bundlers are rich people who have many rich friends, and they bundle all their cash together and give it all at once in the hope of getting an ambassadorship or something else. They don't advertise that they have these bundlers anymore. Instead, what they advertise is how many small dollars donors they have. You know, and how low their average contribution is, and the DNC of all places is even encouraging this with, you know, requiring them to have a certain number of donors to make it into the debates. So money still matters, but the way that you get your money matters even more. So if you get your money from a broad base of people, then that shows a strength, and it also shows an independence, you're at least independent from corporate and big money, but you're not independent from the people who are supporting you, and that actually is a good thing. We do want some dependence when it comes to politics.
If you had to do kind of a short primer for, you know, the average person, when people look at those polls, they don't, you know, with the numbers, they don't know how to interpret them, how to read them. They don't know which line item is important. Is this person's 29 million more important than someone else's 19 million, given, you know, the number of voters? Like, how do you parse that, and how do you recommend people parse that and really understand it rather than becoming confused by it?
First of all, trust your gut. You know, this stuff isn't very complicated. Well, you know, what your gut is telling you is probably right. But, you know, look at the average size of the contribution, and be very careful about candidates who say that X percentage of my contributions came from small donors. So here's why that can be a mess. So The Intercept, where I'm a reporter and an editor, is largely funded by a nonprofit put together by Pierre Omidyar, who's a billionaire who made his money in eBay. That's the bulk of the money. We've been building a small dollar operation that has been quite successful, and we have more than 20,000. You know, members who are giving on a regular basis, you know, whatever they can afford on a month. And so if you say, let's say hypothetically we have 30,000 donors, you know, 29,999 of them are small donors. And so we could say 99.99% of our contributions are from small donors and are, you know, $25 and less. That would be deeply misleading. It would be 100% true. It's accurate. But it doesn't reflect the fact that, yes, that's true, but there's one donor who also makes up the bulk of our funding. Now, fortunately, he's the kind of billionaire that you want to donate. He gives money, and then he just lets us go to do the journalism. That's usually not the case for political candidates. And so if you see somebody say, 94% of my contributions were from small donors, then that means there were 6% of their donors that were not small. How much did each of them give? And if each of them gave a huge amount, then the bulk of it is coming from rich people. And so the number you want to care more about is what percentage of your money came from small donors. Because if you ask that with The Intercept, you'd say, well, actually 80%, I don't know the number, but let's say 80% of our money comes from a big donor and 20% comes from small donors. That would be a much more accurate and reflective way of explaining it than focusing on the number of people rather than the amount of money.
That makes sense. You know, I think because we've been so schooled to capitalism and so schooled to numbers and so schooled to kind of accept this status quo where money talks and the rest of us have to, you know, struggle, and it's been a downhill struggle, I think that's really important to kind of constantly redirect the conversation. One of the things that I really love about We've Got People is that, you know, we've had these broad stroke understandings of, like, for example, what has gone on that has led us to Trump. So, you know, as important as it may be to be outraged and be upset and know what he's doing, it's equally important to have an understanding of how we got there. And I think that from your reporting, you actually sketch out a journey that you know, that shows recent history in terms of key choice points that have, you know, moved us in directions that now we can see in retrospect is non-optimal. And that's not to go after people and, you know, blame them and be enraged or whatever, but if we don't have some kind of constructive scenario of how we got here, other than saying Russia on the one hand, or, you know, these people should have voted in line with everyone and what are you going to do next, then we actually don't have a substantive conversation. What are the key node points or the key moments where you, in your analysis as a longtime reporter and looking backstage at what is really going on in depth behind the scenes, what are the moments where actually we set ourselves up for devolution without even knowing at the time it was happening?
Although some people knew at the time, and it's important to lift up those people who were loudly saying that the wrong choice was being made in real time, which puts into context the decisions. Because it gives more agency to that choice. It's like, you know, there was another choice, and there were people who were arguing for it, but you didn't go that way. And so this is a book for people who have a vague understanding of what's happened over the last 30 years on the left and with the Democratic Party, but don't really have a detailed sense of these pivot points. And I tried to write it in a way. And from everything I've heard from people who've said it's like a page turner, and they've you know, it's a 400-page book, but people are finishing in a day or two, which just makes me so excited, because I wanted to tell a story that people actually wanted to read, because it's an exciting story. And so, you know, to your question about the pivot points, I zero in on a couple of them. 1980 was a huge moment where Ronald Reagan not only wins the White House, but Republicans knock out 12 Democratic senators, and some of the most famous ones of the 20th century were wiped out. McGovern loses in 1980. Frank Church, Birch Bayh, Warren Magnuson. Like, these are the very pillars of liberalism in the 20th century. The people who accomplished what the Democratic Party stood for, and they all got wiped out, and which created this massive crisis of confidence within the Democratic Party. 2006. It was a huge year when Democrats took back the House and the Senate, but did so with the most conservative kind of caucus that they could think of. And then I go deep into the first 2 years of the Obama administration, where a lot of critical decisions were made about what to go for and what not to go for. And then, of course, I was one of the first people covering the Justice Democrats and the Ocasio-Cortez campaign. So I get into the roots of that, and the roots of it really are in the Sanders campaign. And so that's worth, you know, exploring in a more sophisticated way than you get from the kind of drive-by approaches to it in the major media.
Well, that's really true. I mean, in fact, it never ceases to astound me how people, the media ignores it, and a lot of people aren't aware of the fact that, you know, the very people that, for example, we've been hearing from at News Nation today, these wonderful new women of color, congresswomen that came in the 218 Congress, who are now, you know, kind of being, have gotten the nickname the Squad. I mean, the Justice Democrats and Sanders and our revolution were quite instrumental in the fact that they even emerged, that they felt they could run, that they had the support and the tools to run. You know, a lot of people don't even connect that. They sort of see Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez out there, they're impressed by her outspokenness, and then it kind of leads them to, well, we're so grateful we need a woman president, you know, without really understanding the roots of how this has been a development that was carefully crafted and developed over a number of years. So you really get into the weeds on that. I mean, how do you, from your standpoint, see these different people, not as individuals, but as kind of part of a movement or a group? And how instrumental are they, that small group of people that Margaret Mead was always talking about?
Can
have that kind of leverage. I mean, how do you, and you know, this very week, of course, they've been taking a beating from Nancy Pelosi. How do you, in a way, it's a tribute to the leverage they now have, which obviously she's feeling very uncomfortable with. It hasn't translated into, for example, being able to stop ICE and other things that they want. But what do you see as, you know, the moment now and prognosis on all of that based on this deep background?
Well, even I'm surprised a bit at the ferocity of the pushback from the machine in Washington.
Mm-hmm.
Just absolutely extraordinary levels of hostility towards AOC, Ilhan Omar, Rashida Tlaib, to a lesser degree, Ayanna Pressley, but she gets lumped in, a lot of that, and comes collateral damage. It's surprising. I knew that they would not be welcomed with open arms because they represent a fundamental threat to the way that the Democrats do business in Washington. When Pelosi was asked whether or not she thought she had the votes to become speaker again in 2018, if they took over, she said yes. And when they asked, well, how are you so sure? She said, I'm the best fundraiser. And what that is this admission that big money is the thing that drives the party, and she's the best at corralling big money. And so therefore she's going to be the leader of the party. But if you have a party that is no longer organized around simply raising the most big dollars, but instead it's around who's the best at registering unregistered voters, who's the best at turning people out to vote, who's the best at building the foundations of a 20 million, 30 million strong small donor operation, then you need people with different skill sets. So that's why it's such a direct threat to their authority.
Mm-hmm. Well, the interesting thing, too, is that back to the money conversation, which is central to your book and to our discussion today, it's like they have the money, but actually there's a wealth in the people, in the digital strategy, in the capacity for organizing, and in the numbers of people that have been activated by increasing racism and white supremacy, the decline of the middle class, what's happening now to children being separated from families. I mean, this is like, there's actually, we don't call that wealth. We just kind of call that the have-nots screaming. But the have-nots now have this technology in their hands. They have years of experience. I mean, I've often wondered if that's quantifiable. Like, is that worth? Does that actually both in numbers of voters and, you know, in sweat equity and in and will. Mm-hmm. You know, like how can that be calculated when it's, you know, a part, you know, in a more inclusive way than just kind of going, who gets today's label of electability, right, according to the mainstream media?
Well, there's a great clip from Jesse Jackson in the 1980s where he goes over Ronald Reagan's win and lists out how many votes he won by in particular states, and then lists the numbers of unregistered students, unregistered black voters, unregistered, well, not voters, unregistered black people, unregistered Hispanic people. And he's doing it in the context of a David versus Goliath battle. And he refers to these unregistered voters as rocks just lying around. And David just surrounded by rocks and just leaving them there. And it's a very powerful piece of rhetoric, but it's also a mathematical case that's hard to resist, because the numbers were small. Like, yes, Reagan won 40 states and 48 states, you know, an extraordinary number of states in 80 and 84, but he won a lot of those states by a very small amount. And so we go back and we think of it as this massive landslide, when if a small portion of these unregistered voters had been registered and turned out, then it's a different country. And that was Jesse Jackson's point in the 1980s with his campaigns, that that you can change the country, change the type of electorate that we have, rather than having to change your politics to fit the current set of registered voters.
Mm-hmm. So in that context, you know, from what you've seen, like for example, we had a big win with Obama. That was going to be a kind of restoration after the Bush years, hopefully. And yet it did not prove such. You know, what... How did that devolve? Because I feel that's actually, you know, the disappointment of change that we can believe in going down the road that it went is really something that, you know, there's a certain group that weren't affected by it and they still want to recover it. They want to go back and let's elect Biden and we'll do this. We'll have a do-over. We'll go back to the good old days. But I think that's really lacking the kind of analysis that you provide in the book, you know, in terms of what really... You know, where things went off the trails and where that opportunity was misspent, you know.
Right. Right. And there are reasons for that. There are a variety of reasons for that, which I go into. But one of them is that, you know, in 2006 and 2008, they nominated the most conservative Democrat they could in a lot of districts, because they thought that that was the way that they were going to take the majority back. But then when they got to Washington, they were stuck with a lot of these conservative Democrats who then voted against their agenda, consistently. So you have to think more holistically about your electoral politics. You have to connect it to the agenda that you're able to accomplish, because they were not able to bring down unemployment fast enough and get the economy moving fast enough. Because they weren't able to produce a big enough stimulus, because they had constricted thought around what was possible, but also constricted by the conservative members that they had elected, unemployment was too high, and in 2010 became a mess for them.
Yeah. So actually what that speaks to is also, you know, jumping forward to now, is like, who has the holistic strategy, you know, who like we were talking earlier about the connection between AOC and the Sanders folks and the Justice Democrats, but most people are unaware of that. So they're just looking at personality and saying, this is the kind of person that I want to rally around. This is the gender of the person. This is, you know, who we should be rallying around. But the whole fabric, the holistic strategy that you're discussing is really, it's Sanders, and it's that group pretty much that has that.
Right. So you've got to figure out a way to actually accomplish your agenda, and then just prepare for inevitably getting washed out in a country where people are mad and are swinging back and forth. And remember that sometimes you can do everything right policy-wise and politically, but just some natural disaster or something else comes at a certain time and you end up losing your majority. You want to make sure that the policy that you put into place is popular enough that it mm-hmm. can survive. Mm-hmm. Like the Affordable Care Act, note that the only part of it that was repealed was the individual mandate, which everybody hated. Mm-hmm. And so Republicans are like, Democrats are like, resistance is like, okay. If you really want to get rid of that stupid fine for when I can't afford health insurance, go ahead and get rid of that. Pre-existing conditions, the exchanges, the subsidies, don't touch those. Mm-hmm. And that's a very moderate healthcare policy. So mm-hmm. I think Republicans did the same thing with their tax cut. They recognize mm-hmm. they're probably going to lose the House of Representatives. They said, well, we want this policy. Mm-hmm. There's $6 trillion on the table. It might cost us the House, but we'd rather have $6 trillion than have the House of Representatives. And frankly, that's probably the right calculation. What would you rather have? 2 years in the House of Representatives or $6 trillion? I'd probably take the $6 trillion.
That's funny.
Especially if you're probably going to lose it anyway.
What about climate in this whole conversation? I mean, one of the things I really liked about the book as a longtime climate, and gas and fracking reporter and everything, is, how the advanced position in the Democratic Party got really stuck on clean energy. So that's clean energy is the ostensible compromise between I get to take, if I'm a politician, I get to take the gas and oil money and I get to say I'm doing something by putting a name on it. And of course, that's what Clinton was representing, mm-hmm. too. They were just going to retool that. So there's this kind of ambivalence that, and the Paris Climate Accord wasn't doing it. It was never really going to do it. It was like a kind of symbolic, we'll say we're doing something, but it wasn't enforceable. It was just kind of a, goodwill right. type of thing, like a banner that you wave around to claim you're doing something. And, that's it's even more of an issue now as we've kind of pedaled along and in this moderate stance with it for the Democratic Party. Where do you see that as? Right. Today and what lessons
right.
we
as,
have.
As you say, as I write about in the book, the Obama administration did polling mm-hmm. and they concluded that the phrase climate change was problematic. Mm-hmm. Voters didn't like it. And they brought in a bunch of the big green environmental groups and mm-hmm. and gave them their marching orders that they were not to refer to climate change, mm-hmm. Which is different than even saying don't refer to global warming. Definitely don't refer to global warming, but don't mm-hmm. do climate change either. Instead, they said focus on clean energy, which is just a classic Democratic mistake, because you poll something and find that it polls high, and then you move forward with that. But of course, clean energy polls well. Who doesn't like clean energy? I like clean energy. It's the same with lowering drug prices, which has been the, mm-hmm. the focal point of the Democratic messaging around healthcare. That's what the mm-hmm. DCCC tells all its candidates. And so if you poll, should drug prices be lower, you're going to get everyone except pharmaceutical executives mm-hmm. that you get on the phone to say, yes, of course, drug prices should be lower. And so they organize around this extremely popular but vague concept like mm-hmm. clean energy, which then is immediately co-opted by industry. And so it was so predictable what was going to happen. All of a sudden, you see this surge of clean coal. And then you see clean natural gas, because natural gas already had natural.
Already.
Right, in the name. Just slap like clean on there, too. Yeah. And you practically want to drink the stuff.
When they were pushing back on the Green New Deal, there was a guy that was saying natural gas is good for your health because it's good for business in his state. And he was like equating the two.
Yeah, so there you go.
I don't know if he's ready to drink it yet.
And even with gasoline, they'd say it's cleaner burning fuel. And so when you see the actual substantive turf, then the opposition is easily going to just adopt your rhetoric. you now have the drug industry, you know, fully embracing lower drug prices. You know, you can guess for yourself how much you can trust them as reliable partners in that fight. But that is now 100% their rhetoric, and they're involved in negotiations with the House and the Trump administration, ostensibly aimed at lowering drug prices. And so everybody agrees. We all want lower drug prices. But when you stand for something that everybody supports, you end up standing really for nothing, because you haven't actually found an issue that has a contradiction in it.
Well, do you feel that way about Medicare for All as it now stands, or free college tuition? I mean, are those also sweeping but undefined, or they're not getting caught in that?
To me, those are different because they have a thrust and a policy direction to them. Mm-hmm. So if you say, I support free college, voters don't read that as great. If you're elected, then next semester, I'm going for free. You know, no room and board, no tuition, nothing. What the voter hears is that the person recognizes that college costs are out of control, that the student loan crisis is a disaster, and that they want to do something to make college more affordable and more accessible to more people. And then you're going to hammer out and negotiate the details, but it has a direction. Medicare for All also has a direction. It's saying insurance companies are a major problem. The profit motive in healthcare is a problem, and everybody ought to be covered. You know, within that framework, there's tons of room for negotiation, and people understand that that's going to shake out in a variety of different ways. But they see which direction it's going. If you just say, well, I'm for clean energy, that doesn't really tell anybody. You're just for cleaner energy. Okay. I'm for that. You know, maybe even put some solar panels on roofs. But it's not in opposition to anything. Whereas with free college and with Medicare for All, it is clear who would be against those ideas.
We're talking today with Ryan Grimm, author of We've Got People, From Jesse Jackson to Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, The End of Big Money and the Rise of a Movement. So, you know, let's talk about the movement side of this. When you were citing your subscribership numbers on the Intercept, actually, I was kind of impressed.
Oh,
I mean,
good.
You know, because part of what
and
we're
everybody else should join too.
You know, part of the problem is these episodic phrases. You know, people have a short attention span, very short, brief, superficial ideas are put out there as branding concepts to kind of hook people. And then your book and The Intercept is kind of functioning to get deeper into the weeds and give a more in-depth perspective. What are your strategies for doing that? And do you really feel like that it's the movement that's following what you do and that the movement is growing? Like
I don't know if they're following what I do, but there does seem to be a movement, and it seems to be the energy is being compressed and increased by the threat of climate change.
Right.
As young people have a genuine and realistic, you know, existential fear about, you know, what the future is going to hold for them.
Right.
That's producing a different risk calculus that existed in the past. If you think of history as one long thread that maybe bends in the right direction, you worry more about short-term losses. You might worry more about, say, losing to Ronald Reagan in 1980 or losing to George W. Bush. And so you might say, well, you know, don't get behind this third party movement because you might throw the election to George W. Bush. And that becomes the major risk. But if you throw planetary catastrophe into the question as another risk that's part of the political process, then you have to start taking that into account. And so nominating a Bernie Sanders or an Elizabeth Warren might let's pretend that Joe Biden were a a good general election candidate. I don't think he is, but let's pretend that he was. So if you don't nominate Biden, then your risk in that situation would be that Trump wins another election. But when you throw in the planetary crisis, the risk of not nominating a Sanders or a Warren is increased, because now you're not taking, you know, one of the last moments that you have, seizing it to address the crisis. And so it puts a new element into the equation that just simply wasn't really there before.
That's really true. Yeah, that's really true. And, you know, I just have to backtrack and ask why you don't think Biden is a good candidate for beating Trump, since you mentioned that.
Well, just empiricism, for one. He ran in 1988. That was his year. That was a Democratic year. Mm-hmm. He'd been in the Senate for a nice amount of time at that point, elected in 72. He was, you know, he's a young, articulate guy. Gives good stump speeches. He's got the working class vibe, but he's also like done some civil rights work. Like, he had represented big business in Delaware, so he should have had connections to money. He had everything lined up for him at that point. And he completely flopped, and he went out in a ridiculous plagiarism scandal, but he was already, basically out of the race. Due to like the complete lack of interest in him from voters. So then he runs again in 2008, another Democratic year. He's got 20 more years of experience at this point. Experience is a thing that could possibly have been an asset in that year after Bush completely blowing the world economy to pieces. And again, he gets like 0.5% in Iowa and drops out. Pitiful candidate. He enters this time again 20 years later, 10 years later, and starts at 40-some% in the polls, and just immediately starts nosediving. So the arrow on his poll numbers has a very clear direction. The way that you can tell that he's not out on the campaign trail is that you don't see him in the news apologizing for something idiotic and awful that he said and meant the day before. Here we are, it's Saturday. We haven't heard a Biden gaffe in several days, and you can bet that that's because he simply hasn't done any campaign events. So that's his campaign's explicit strategy, that to just keep him in his living room until Iowa. And you just can't do that, because you have to come out for debates. You have to come out once in a while. And when people also, Iowa's very retail politics, and when you see him in person, he just looks not all there. He looks his age or more. Age at that age, very much depends on is a case by case thing. You can be 75 and seem 65. You can be 75 and seem 90. He's on the opposite end.
Yeah, he's had a rough life.
Yeah,
he earned it. But
he did, and he's traveling to Wilmington every single night. The Amtrak is comfortable, but that's a rough commute. That is.
Yeah, and then all the family crisis. I mean, there's trauma, and
bookended by trauma.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of trauma. I mean, since we're on the age topic, and it's not really core to your examination, and, we've got people, but I sometimes have the impression that the political divide in the liberal, moderate, progressive, whatever you want to call it, end of the spectrum, is really generational. So you have the younger generation who is, many of them, more enthused for an older candidate who maintained integrity over the decades that all of this was kind of heading south. And then you have older people who are like, oh, people are too old, we need a younger candidate. But actually, at heart of it, and this is like my little question as someone who's covered climate, one group is going to be dealing with the outcome of our climate trajectory, and the other group is not, and just wants to kind of steady state until I'm out of here. I mean, and
y'all boomers,
yeah,
plague on this earth until the day you die. It's true. It is interesting that the older people have much more concern about the older candidates than the younger. The older people have more of a concern about older candidates than younger people do.
That's right.
Which is not exactly how you would think of it. And in a lot of ways, the younger people are much more skeptical of these younger candidates too. Mm-hmm. It's old people that love Buttigieg. He looks like this wonderful grandson or nephew. Who they're so proud of, whereas young people look at him and are like, I know this kid. He ran for class president in eighth grade, and he's been running for something ever since. And just not, they see through him much more easily. But yeah, there certainly is a more palpable sense of crisis around the climate with young people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And really, if you know, I think part of it is A, the older generation may not be around, and B, they haven't factored it in. So as the brain cells harden, unless you've factored in these changes, you know, the mention mm-hmm. of socialism, what happens to my pension, you know, all of these things, and it actually becomes harder to change your
pension?
Mind. What?
What's a pension?
What's a pension?
What's this thing you speak of?
Yeah. No, I mean, but it's like, you know, it's like you can't, there's a much more varied world. So it's, you know, with many more diverse elements to integrate, to take in, to learn about, you know, and it's harder to do, you know, with hardening of brain function as life progresses. I mean, that's just, you know, biological mm-hmm. kind of reality. And yet,
the traveling is hard too.
What?
The traveling. Like,
yeah.
To Iowa, to New Hampshire, to South Carolina, to Nevada, to here, Elizabeth Warren here in Pennsylvania today. She'll be back in Washington tomorrow. And then,
yeah.
you know, when the Senate's out, God knows, you know, back to Massachusetts, mm-hmm. back to mm-hmm. Iowa, back mm-hmm. to Nevada.
Mm-hmm.
And people like Warren and Sanders complicated for themselves with their everyman message, because there they are in the aisle seat or in the middle seat in coach. Not, you know, Tom Steyer probably cruising in here in a private jet.
Of course.
Because he's a billionaire, you know, he's not trying to pretend he's an everyman.
Yeah.
But, that, you know, that's tough.
Yeah.
It takes a toll on me. I'm not a spring chicken anymore. I'm mm-hmm. 41.
Mm-hmm.
But just traveling to Philadelphia.
Yeah.
From D.C.
Yeah.
Wears me out.
Yeah. No, I mean, it's a thing. Yeah, I came down from New York City for this. So, yeah.
Yeah, you don't sleep as well. You don't eat as well.
Yeah, that's right. Drinking too much coffee and all of that. Mm-hmm. Yep. And other things. But, yeah, no, but it's also connecting digitally, you know, and here we are at Netroots Nation, connecting digitally, which is what we do all the time, and connecting, you know, socially in the same space, face to face and all of that. That's something, you know, that doesn't happen. I mean, we're really actually, in terms of politics, the people who are in sync on some of these really, truly progressive campaigns are actually, you know, a far-flung nationwide virtual team that are in touch in whole different ways and levels. And I think that is the great potential for this movement, but it's also, you know, it's also not the same as being in physical and local community. I was interviewing Damon Drummer, who is one of the architects from New Consensus of the, you know, plans for the Green New Deal, and they're talking about building out on local, state, regional, and federal levels, and really kind of instead of, you know, and really reinvesting in people on the local level too, which is something we haven't really seen. Mm-hmm. I mean, the local level, the community level, has really been plundered by the way things are going. Now, I mean, how do you see the socialist tag as a a debit or an advantage. I mean, there are some studies that say younger people are like, I'm over, I'm done with this capitalism. It's not serving us at all. There are many communities that are just been completely disenfranchised by it. They see their elected officials captured, but then they're, Americans traditionally have been taught to be, fearful of the term. I mean, what is your perspective?
I mean, it depends in a lot of ways on where you are and but if you seem authentic and you seem like you're in it for the right reasons and you can articulate what those are, then I think they're gonna give you a shot. And and if you have the right enemies, which is one of Trump's greatest gifts, he has a lot of the right enemies, which are Chris Cuomo, CNN. Like he's good at identifying who the public doesn't like and pitting himself against them. Then that actually helps with your credibility a lot too.
We've got people, you kind of take us through several administrations with how things devolved, both publicly and also in ways that people haven't carefully tracked to put us where we are. What would be your best counsel to people now looking at 20 candidates, looking at their own identities of I'm this type of person or that type of person, I want to see somebody like me up there, or maybe I don't care about that. I mean, how do people not get overwhelmed and confused and actually use their vote and their support in the best way so that we really get a good result rather than something that's fragmented and episodic? Because it seems to me like we're at risk for that.
What I would say is that people should not assume that they know the future. They should not assume that they're soothsayers and that they can predict who's going to be the best general election candidate against Donald Trump. I think whenever the Democratic primary electorate tries to play pundit, they end up screwing it up. They were so sure that Howard Dean was unelectable. They loved Howard Dean, but they just didn't think that Republicans would go for him. So they nominated a war hero, John Kerry, because they figured nobody can challenge his credentials in a time of war. You go back to Dukakis or Mondale. One of the few times that Democratic primary voters have not listened to that kind of devil on their shoulder warning them against following their hearts was in 2008 with Barack Obama. Everybody told them, you can't, this is America. We're only 7 years after 9/11. You can't elect somebody named Barack Hussein Obama. Nobody's ever heard of. You certainly, the country's not ready to elect a black man president. Look at Hillary Clinton. She's a senator. She's, first lady. She's wildly popular in these polls in the mid 2000s. Go with the safe electable choice. And Democratic voters, to their credit, said A, they did not forgive her for her vote for the Iraq War, and B, they said, this guy looks great. I don't care whether or not Republicans are going to go for him or not. And they nominated him, and he goes on to win the first majority for Democrats since the 1970s. Because remember, Clinton got 43% because Ross Perot, rest in peace, pulled 19% out of that. The same in 96, a similar situation in 96. And then he reelected with a majority in 2012. But they didn't take the lesson from that if they go for who they want, then maybe there's something to that person that can be sold to the public. Instead, Republicans took that lesson, and everyone told Republicans that Donald Trump is just not electable, and for good reason. Donald Trump? Are you kidding me? But they said, he's speaking to me. This is the person we want to represent the Republican Party in the general election fight. And Democrats, whatever they thought about Bernie Sanders' message, just, Hillary Clinton, it's her turn. Let's give her the shot. She's electable. She's serious. and we know how that turned out. So you know, as you head into 2020, I'd say cast aside the arrogance that you know how things are going to unfold. Nobody does. Nobody knows what precisely is going to win Pennsylvania, Michigan, and Wisconsin, those states you need. You don't know if it's going to be these people in the diner that the media are obsessed with, or whether it's the people in Milwaukee who decided not to vote because they were unenthused, or the people in Ann Arbor who voted third party because they didn't like their choices. 2018 showed that you can get a lot of those people back in the Democratic fold. And if you do that, if you go for the people who voted Jill Stein, voted Gary Johnson, or stayed home, you're going to incidentally, almost accidentally, win a decent number of those people who swung from Obama to Trump. You're going to get the ones that are gettable. The ones that aren't gettable, you're not going to get anyone. And so it's better to get them collaterally by going for the others than it is to target them by moderating your message and pissing off the 95% of the rest of your electorate. So that's what I would say. Be more humble and just trust yourself.
That's great. Thank you. We've been talking with Brian Grimm. We've Got People. It's his new book, and it's out from Strong Arm Press. You can find it online, and we'll also be tagging the book to all of our social media for this broadcast. If you've enjoyed the show, share it with people. It'll be in the Connect the Dots podbean.com archive after this live show. Thank you so much for being with us.
Oh, thank you for having me.
And here in the next part of our show with an important update about some recent activities in the public life and media is Andres Bernal, who is a proponent of modern monetary theory. He is a doctoral student, a research fellow at the Global Institute for Sustainable Prosperity, and also a visiting research fellow at the University of Missouri, Kansas City Department of Economics. His research focus is on the Green New Deal as a site of political communication and policy analysis. He's also a close advisor to Representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. Welcome back to Connect the Dots, Andres. So nice to have you here again. Hi.
Good to be back.
Yeah. In the last 10 days, literally at the time that I recorded the interview that listeners have just heard with Ryan Grimm, we've had a real kind of jolt in the American body politic. Representative Ocasio-Cortez with her colleagues, Representative Tlaib, Representative Omar, and Representative Presley took a stand against a vote on an immigration funding allocation of almost $5 billion without any oversight. That was kind of a blank check given to Donald Trump. These four legislators, who are now sort of somehow have come to be called collectively the squad, took a stand and said, no, this is not okay. For this courage and stance of integrity, they were publicly chastised by House Speaker Nancy Pelosi. And then subsequent to that, the president, or as Representative Presley calls him, the current occupant of the White House, took it upon himself to further attack them with racist and white supremacist remarks that really escalated the kind of ugly racism that we've seen so much of on so many different levels in the current administration. The House of Representatives responded by censuring him for these words, and we're now in a kind of aftermath of, you know, that compounded incident, with more eyes on ICE and on the detention / concentration camps in which young children are held apart from their parents in terrible conditions. I'm wondering, from your perspective, what is the current status? What is the takeaway from this series of interlocking incidents?
Well, I think that's a very interesting question. One of the big takeaways, for me at least, is just the way that so much of the kind of liberal establishment was shocked to hear Donald Trump, you know, say these white supremacist things, and to hear so much of his base chanting for Ilhan to be sent back. A lot of people are kind of reacting by being very shocked. And, you know, that's not surprising to me, but it's very telling because it kind of just shows how clueless a lot of people are, even though they probably themselves think that they have good intentions. There's just this layer of historical ignorance about the experiences of people that are not white in this country or not considered white, or this belief that like bad things happened a long time ago, but that was all settled or you know, some things like that. So I think also there's this kind of dancing around from a lot of the establishment around whether Donald Trump should be called a white supremacist or not, or a racist or not. And some people, you know, Nancy Pelosi kind of walked back some comments she made, and then she went ahead and said his words were racist, but not necessarily him himself. So, you know, it's things like that. I think we're kind of really used to a situation of where whatever party you belong to, you know, certain people kind of manage what's okay and what happens. And, you know, Donald Trump hasn't really cared much to really put forward what he wants and frame the conversation under what he believes gets the most excitement behind him. And it's been working for him very well. And I think a lot of the establishment is more afraid of progressives and more overt anti-racist politics, more overt working class-based politics to have a larger platform now. So they're afraid of kind of losing control on that end too. And, you know, what's kind of scary is sometimes it seems as though they're okay letting a little bit of this, you know, very vulgar white supremacist rhetoric grow, so long as they feel they're still in control of the quote-unquote resistance. But clearly, I mean, I think that they have no idea how to resist. So it's a scary situation. I think that what's most concerning is the danger that these representatives are being put in now by the president's words. We're kind of really seeing this battle for the soul of society. And we, you know, we really thought that we had moved on from the 1960s. But again, you know, what I often tell people is if you have slavery for a couple hundred years, and then you have outright terrorism against indigenous and black communities after slavery is abolished, And then finally in the 1960s, you have movements for civil rights, and we get some legislation passed that gains some important ground. That doesn't mean that, like, all of a sudden all of this toxicity and animosity disappears. I mean, it's there. All of those hundreds of years have made an impact on our collective psyche, and they're deeply ingrained in our unconscious. Regardless of your political beliefs, it's there. It's part of our history. It's something that has been passed down from, you know, one generation to another, things that we learn as we grow up. And so right now, we have the legacy of this toxicity and this vitriol very, very alive still. And in some ways kind of frantic that it's going to lose its standing, that it's going to lose its position in society, that it's going to be erased. And so, you know, people confuse this idea that all of this diversity is trying to erase the existence of white people, but that's of course completely misses the point that, you know, first of all, what we consider whiteness is not this natural thing, but this kind of socially and politically constructed thing, and that the thing that people are trying to overcome or erase is this sentiment, this power over other people, this kind of reality where some people have social dominance over others. And I think that that's a completely reasonable thing to fight and to want to overcome.
You know, I think the liberal moderate centrist stance as expressed in the 2016 Clinton candidacy was just, oh, you know, if you looked at the convention, you know, it was just a series of videos of people highlighted from different ethnic backgrounds, each of whom was allowed to break through the glass ceiling and enter the American dream. In other words, as if economic equity under capitalism for a few individuals, you know, kind of erased the fact that for the overall, there is this economic lack of opportunity, and, you know, actually all the way to rather severe oppression. And yet, you know, the whitewash is I'm a liberal and I'm not prejudiced. If, you know, I'm happy that a Muslim American, you know, becomes a lawyer or something. And so, I think it's really a call and invitation to everyone to look more deeply at what's really going on rather than cosmetically regarding oneself, self-designating as, you know, not, you know, as benign in this whole situation. And, you know, and now we see it, as you point out. Final words before we check out of this week's edition of Connect the Dots?
I think that the last thing I say is that however difficult the situation is, and it is a very, very exhausting, difficult, scary situation, it does present an opportunity, I think, to build on our legacy of civil rights and the incomplete struggle which that was, and continue that struggle in a way that I think brings a lot more knowledge and understanding to the rest of the population or to the people that are ready and willing to listen about what exactly is racism, what is white supremacy, how these forms of cultural domination go hand in hand with economic inequality and capitalism. I think that's very important because oftentimes one of the difficulties now, and I think the big task of this country and this society, is to understand how systems of domination on cultural grounds, on social grounds, are interconnected and emerged at the same time with economic exploitation and class society. And sometimes we just think about one and not the other. And so that work, that's our homework, I would say. And what other opportunity would we have to do this than in a moment of crisis and, you know, utter despair like we are in now? We have to keep building the hope ourselves through our own actions.
Thank you. And also through the candidates that we support and taking a stand with them and pressuring government to move the dial here, all of the above. Thank you so much for being with us again today on Connect the Dots, Andres Bernal. Wonderful kind of direction out of this whole situation. Thank you.
Okay, everybody, next week, Wednesday, 10 a.m. Eastern Time for Connect the Dots. Keep marching forward in company with all our relations. Be well this week. I'm Alison Rose Levy.